Today we're going to talk about the psychodynamic model, which is a fascinating model, and also really confusing and complex. We're just going to scrape the surface. What's interesting from the psychodynamic model is its focus on the unconscious and this awareness that we're not always aware of everything that's going on around us. And Sigmund Freud is really instrumental in helping us think about that. Key psychodynamic principles: childhood experiences shape the adult personality. The causes and purposes of human behavior may be outside awareness. We use defense mechanisms to control anxiety, and everything we do is meaningful. Here are Freud's psychosexual stages. He talks about children dealing with different kinds of issues at various points in their lives in a very predictable way, and dealing with particular psychological tasks. If you look at Eric Erickson's description of these things, you know, pull out your general psych textbook, you'll see that they are actually fairly similar in the oral stage. Both of them talk about this issue of attempting to create or feel trust in the world, trust in their caregivers. In the anal stage, both are learning how to control their body and to control their world. You know, so look there. The idea here is that there is an issue that needs to be addressed. For example, can I believe that the world is a safe place? And if that is not resolved well, then it continues to haunt us even into adulthood. Freud talks about three structures of the psyche. The id is what we are born with. You know, we are only, you know, these desires and have no ability to, you know, get those desires met. So we may respond, you know, we're hungry and we cry. We are, you know, our diapers are dirty and we cry and try and meet those needs. The ego begins to develop late in the first year. So as that child is hungry and, you know, is crawling around the floor, sees some Cheerios, picks them up and puts it in, you know, in its mouth, there is this desire from the id that is satisfied by the ego. Now imagine if we were only id and ego. Id, you know, we have a desire and we meet it. The superego develops around age two. So at around age two, my oldest daughter would walk around saying, "Mommy said no." And you could hear her conscience developing. That's our superego, which has both positive aspects, what is it that we want, and negative ones. What don't we want? What don't we want to be like? You can hear in this conflict between the id and the superego that, you know, both the id and superego aren't going to go in the same direction. Often, their goals are different, and that causes some anxiety. Now, we can handle some of that anxiety directly. So, for example, the ego might say, "Yeah, you want a cookie right now, but, you know, let's hold off. If you wait until, you know, 3 o'clock, it'll be an okay time to do it." But often we don't handle that anxiety directly. We don't problem solve. And instead, we rely on defense mechanisms. Now, these defense mechanisms can sometimes be very positive. So, for example, sublimation can be a wonderful defense mechanism. You know, so I may be feeling a lot of anxiety about getting, you know, everything done that I need to do. And if I were to, you know, go and run, that would be a positive way of handling that. Now, if the only thing I do is run, that's probably going to be problematic. First of all, because, you know, doing anything too much is a problem. And secondly, because it doesn't help me solve the problem. And that's really what I want to do. So let's talk our way quickly through these defense mechanisms. You'll find others in the book. Repression is the most basic of the defense mechanisms, where we're pushing unacceptable feelings, you know, from awareness. I don't even want to think about it. Most other defense mechanisms are variations on this, where, again, we're not even thinking. Projection, rather than paying attention to the feelings in myself, I'm going to be thinking about them in someone else. So, for example, it may cause me a lot of anxiety to be aware of, you know, that I don't want to have a child. And so, rather than pay attention to that, I may be noticing how other people don't want to have a child. Reaction formation transforms those unacceptable feelings to the polar opposite. So, for example, you know, instead of recognizing that I don't want to have a child, I may experience the exact opposite. I may really spend a lot of time focusing on children and focusing on how much I want that child. Intellectualization is cutting off our unacceptable feelings and focusing on the thoughts. So sometimes feelings are overwhelming. You may have been diagnosed with some sort of disease, and rather than feeling the anxiety and fear associated with that, you spent all your time the first week or two on the internet and looking, you know, discovering more about what's going on there. Now, underlying all of these ideas is this idea that many of our impulses are unacceptable and we don't believe that we can be aware of them. So they're outside of our awareness and they cause a variety of different kinds of problems. What Freud said is that in a dream, for example, they are transformed into a more acceptable image. That's our manifest content. The latent content, this conflict, is outside of our awareness. That can be tapped in a number of different ways. We can begin to see what's happening in this conflict. We can't ask directly, but we can see it, you know, in responses to Rorschach cards or free associations or dreams, you know, in what kinds of things are saying, or in the kinds of mistakes that someone makes. So let's think about the good and the bad and the ugly with a psychodynamic model. It is a complex model that has been extremely influential in the arts and in psychology. Although sometimes we don't even recognize some of those places where we see it. It really gives us a complicated and way of understanding what's going on with human behavior. There are some difficulties. It doesn't really test the aspects of its model in the way that people from, for example, a cognitive model would really prefer, and they are really good at doing. And there are also some concepts that are really difficult for many people to understand and accept, and so that also causes some problems. So, what should you do now? First, write down your dreams for a period of several days. How does the manifest content, the stuff that you see, reflect what's going on in your days? Then also think about what themes or latent content you observe. What kinds of feelings do you experience? And notice what kinds of insights you get about yourself as you do this. And then notice yourself or someone else using one or more of the defense mechanisms. You might come home from a really tough day at work and your dog jumps up on you and you get upset. If you attribute your upsetness to the dog rather than to what happened earlier in the day, you're using displacement, which is a kind of defense mechanism. If this is easier to do with someone else, think about why. And as you do, you'll have a good idea of what's happening from the psychodynamic point of view. In our next video, we're going to talk about humanism. Have a good day.